we are normally doing is that I will ask you to speak about 5-10 minutes, and then we engaging with the audience and discussing the issues of interest. Thank you for coming again. It's a great honor and pleasure to have you here, and the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. It's my honor to be here. It's my pleasure to be here, and I hope it will be interesting in one hour in our lives. You know? And if I identify myself, usually the speakers identify themselves. You know, you see, this is an order of excellence of the president of Georgia, and this is a Heritage Foundation tag. You know who I am.
No offense to liberals, right?
No, I'm just a man of the world. I really had already two talks in Georgia yesterday with the students, and it was about the EU and NATO and 10 years of Latvia's experience in the EU. This morning I have a talk to military, young military, and this was a talk about the role of the military in the modern world, and I think this is the right time to talk about the world order. And if you come back to the history, it was a bipolar world of Cold War, but we had to really acknowledge that it was an understandable world. There were two oppositions talking to each other, sometimes, sometimes not, and they were determining the history of world order for a very long time. 25 years ago, this order collapsed. And we were very happy because we said, this is the end of Cold War. Yes, true, it was an end of the Cold War. But then some people were started to talk about that this unipolar world. And there were a lot of people in the world who said, this is not a good world order. And then they started to talk about multipolar world and enjoyed it. But I'm sorry to say that for a very short period of time, because these artificial structures of bricks or whatever you call them, then they're not going to work because they're artificial. And if somebody asks ourselves, what's the world order right now, we have also to be frank to ourselves, we have a part of the globe with an order, and a part of the world without any order. And if we speak about the part of the order, at present we are in Georgia, it's a part of the world with the order, with the rule of law, with democratic principles, with freedoms we all really care about. And this practically is Europe, America, Australia, Japan, New Zealand, and many other countries. And I read in a newspaper a few days ago that somebody of the journalists added to this world of order the Kurdish part of Iraq. That was very exciting about that. And people look at the new world order as a stability of rule of law. Whatever the law is, but that's a rule of law. And then the other part of the world, which is without order. And if you compare with the wrestling sports, boxing has some rules. The classical wrestling has some rules. Jiu-jitsu has some rules. Even Kung Fu has some rules. But you sometimes watch on the TV wrestling without rules. Very difficult to say who is going to win and what will be the key to the success in the wrestling without rules. And now you have, you know, many places in the world with no rules at all, and with no order at all. But if you look at the present situation in our region, that is in Europe and in Asia, there was some nostalgia by some countries to the situation of Cold War. And if we see the China in the modern world, it's trying to creeping in a creeping way to change the world order or the world rules. If you look at the Russia, they don't care about the rules at all anymore. Because they want the bipolar world to back in the future. And if you look at the development of the Russian military politics and about the international policies, they don't obey any rules existing international community. And Putin was always saying, we'll do anything, even the declarations, we'll do anything we know what's in our interests, but only in the framework of international law. What we see today, I want you to remember, 6 years ago, just before the Georgian-Russian war, Russia left the Conventional Forces Treaty in Europe. That was the only treaty about the conventional forces, how they are dislocated in the Europe, and there was controlling of the numbers and the regions. Russia just left. And we were not able to react. We said, oh, we cannot do anything because that's the opposite side decision. And Putin's argument was very, nobody is going to tell me where to dislocate my armed forces in my territory. And in the end point you have, you know, armed forces, you know, 35 of me, how many kilometers from Tbilisi? Because nobody is going to control that. The next point, of course, the Crimea and the eastern part of Ukraine is a big challenge to the world order. Because this is a violation of Helsinki Act, everybody agreed that the borders are not going to change. To do it today, if you watch the Russian TV, they are talking about Russia's new territories. It's very corresponding, I said in the morning, you know, to the time that the colonial powers claimed the overseas territories. The New England, the New South Wales, whatever, you know, New York, whatever you call it. But this is in many centuries ago. It's not the thinking of today. And secondly, you know, who is going to trust? Because the world order is based on trust and confidence on each parties. If the Budapest Memorandum is legally not binding paper, what we are going to talk about? A memorandum signed on nuclear arms, is it just a paper, non-legally binding paper? That's something new. And of course, the annexion, the occupation, the annexion, and by the colonization of Crimea, is something which should not happen in the 21st century. And we should never admit it as a regular or normal practice in the international relations. So we have a lot of challenges to do. What would be the best ever reaction from the Western world towards such a neglection of all international laws and orders? I asked this question about half a year ago in Berlin. I said, you know, if somebody is violating a law in your country, what's the consequence? You go to court and prove that somebody is guilty and somebody has to be punished. In this case, are we ready to go to international criminal court and say Russia is guilty? Still silence, even in this room. Even in this room, there's still a silence. So are we ready? Are we matured enough in our development of international legal framework to go to court, international court, and say Russia is guilty? No. Sorry, not today. So what we can do just one thing, which is only adequate reaction for the Western world. Unite more, cooperate more, strengthen the competitiveness of our economies, strengthen the military force of our alliances. And that's why all these topics about the free trade between America, North America and Europe is the first priority. The free trade agreements between, you know, America, Japan and Australia is, it's called trans-Pacific, you know, transatlantic free trade, trans-Pacific free trade. We have to really show the world that the part with the order and the rule of law is the best for the better off of the countries and the people of these countries. Because if you compare the countries and the societies which are based on the values and look at the whole world, they are always better off than dictatorships, than non-democratic countries. That's true. And the best example is Korea. Very simple, visible example. The same people, the same tradition, the same language, the same religion. Whatever you say is the same, except the order of law on the northern part and on the southern part. And you see who is better off. And of course, you can survive as Cuba, you can survive as Northern Korea, even if the Russia is isolating absolutely 100% from the outer world, they will survive. But they'll never be better off. That's true. Because they can be happy like a tribe in the rainforest. They all are happy, but they are not better off. There's no development, it's just, you know, survival in the wild environment of the nature. Do we want that? No, I don't think we want. So, what is the role of Georgia on this map of the world order? That's a question to you. But it's very important to understand. Are you the nation of the rule of law and order and democracy? Or the opposite? I will not define what's the opposite. And there's no other choices. And we will be back to the bipolar world, which will be a world of order against a world of disorder. A world of rule of law against a dictatorship. Democracy, dictatorship. So, it seems easy. But we have to ask the questions to ourselves, what we can do, each of us, as an individual, as a nation, as a state, to increase the territories of the world of order. That, to my mind, is the main question of today. And as soon as we'll have the answer, we'll get the successful results. But we have to go to different directions. One is that we have to create the legal framework for the governance of the world. Then we have to go to the United Nations. Because the United Nations are not effective right now. They're not effective right now. The Security Council is just vetoing solutions in any case because all the big players have the veto rights. And these veto are not used for solutions, the veto are used for non-solutions. And this should be changed. How? It's not an answer yet because the discussion about the reorganization of the Security Council, maybe UN as a whole, this is one of the questions we have to answer before we create the legal framework for international relations. And this framework should be respected by all countries. If you don't respect international agreements and treaties and law, nobody is going to build the confidence and trust that's necessary for successful economic development. Maybe EU, a few words about the EU. We are the member states of the EU since 10 years. We had 10 more years just to get in. Now we really see the benefits and we're really integrated in the EU. We understand this is one of the modern models of living together under the same values, based on the same principles, and being free. Free society, free market economy, freedom of not only choice, freedom of speech and all other things. And if some people, the students asked me yesterday, you have many Euroskeptics. I said, so what? You need Euroskeptics to understand the European decision is right. You need some opponents to tell you are not doing right. Because otherwise you become self-satisfied, you will make mistakes. You need opposition. You need opposite views, and this is normal, and these views must be respected. So, can you imagine that all 28 have different cultures, different histories, different pain, different memories, and different attitude towards the life attack as resistance? You can't eliminate these differences, but you can successfully live together and be strong together. That's what I think is the EU role in the global order change. So I would not like to be too long, just a short summary about what I think about the world order and what I think about Georgia on the world map. It's an important place. Because we are all here today.
Thank you, Mr. President. Excellent, and very eloquent said. And let me move to the more interactive phase of our conversation, our today's conversation. And I will take liberty of asking my first question. So, excellently good. World, or at least European order, is challenged. And the answer is unite more, in your words, solidarity of the democratic, more solidarity of the democratic nations. Let's focus on what nowadays is called the hybrid war. Some people call it the asymmetric war. That includes not only the military, paramilitary component, but also the economy, energy, and information, weaponization of information. It has not started with Kiev or Ukraine or Georgia, and Latvia is one of the first countries that experienced the information war on itself, even in the 90s. I remember all those fake informations about how Latvians are really badly treating the Russian speakers, and then there were a really huge wave of disinformation actually aimed at preventing Latvia from entering into the NATO and then into the European Union. We have to admit that the certain circles in the free world are very vulnerable to this kind of warfare, which really very modern warfare, in combination with hard power and economic power can do the big damage. Please tell us, how do you see this, particularly the information war on the Western values, let's put it in this way, and what would be the best way to deal with it?
Okay. One of the answers will be when the soft war started 25 years ago. We have to say 25 years ago. We didn't recognize that. That's our problem. But look how many wars we have really created in the last 2 years. Proxy war, cyber war, media war, hybrid war. You see, we understand that the military combat is just a part of the war. Now it's much more wide scale definition of what's war. because all the principles how the war starts and how the war is prepared are absolutely different from the other let's say experience before. Because what is a war indeed, if you make a definition? It's just one of the processes to achieve definite political goals. And a week ago, one Russian diplomat just said publicly in the conference, he said, the West is not smart enough to understand the rationality of military policies of Russia. We invaded Georgia, but we stepped back instead of occupying the whole Georgia. And we took just Crimea and started the hybrid war in the eastern part of Ukraine, but we are not going forward, you know, we could do it. That's, listen, it's a very, very dangerous way of arguing the Russia's policies. What we have to do, because if we compare Georgia and Latvia, you have experienced the war. War is the end point for you, and it's 6 years ago. And you lived 6 years in post-war situation, and there are no leverages from Russia on you. You have to understand, Russia has used all the force. Russia took over your territories, but they cannot influence you politically. That's one thing. In our case, this is much more difficult. I'll tell you very frankly, it's much more difficult. We have a population, let's say we have a minority of 27% which are Russians. 27% of our population are Russians. We have free media, they watch Russian TV every day. They really live in Russia, in their minds. They just work and have all the leisure in Latvia. And most of them like Putin, but they would like the Putin to be a president in Latvia is just one exception. They want the political system and the economical system and all the freedoms like in Latvia, which is not possible. So, but this is what we really, it's our strengths. Because what we sell the euro, they're not going to change the euro for ruble. They are not going to change the protection of property and rights, instead of those rights and investment rights protection which exists in Russia. They even move the capitals, you know, towards our country, towards West, you know. They are not going to really say we don't like the freedom of speech. We don't like the freedom of expression. We don't like. They will never say that. They will never go to that way. Of course, they're Russians, and in their emotions, they are for Crimea. Yes, and they really believe that they are fascists in Ukraine. Not all the 37, but about one third. That's true. So, one of the typical soft war attacks on my country is the media attack. And if you have about 20 TV stations broadcasting in Russian, even if you put two or three to fight back, it's not enough. It's not enough. So we have to focus on something else. We cannot win in a media battle. So we are focusing on what's called, you know, internal security of the people. They feel secure at home. They feel secure at their jobs, they feel secure at their businesses, their travel, their work. They feel like a free person. And that's what we have to put back. So it's much cheaper to invest in the local security, the internal security, just to trace all the radical groups, just to trace all any tension which is possible threat to our internal stability, just to kill immediately. And that is cheaper, that we can do, because we have to deal with 2 million people, and not to deal, you know, with hundreds of million rubles in the media war. So we have to adapt asymmetrically. That's 100% true. Cyber attacks, that's the reality. And what we have done, that we have really organized a command center of cyber defense, not in any other telecommunications ministry, but in the Ministry of Defense. So the cyber defense and military defense are all together and very close working with this, what we call media defense. That's something new we are doing. And counter-propaganda. We have to do that because we live on the border with Russia. And they will try to destabilize in any way our society. And that's our main priority, to have a stable society in our country. Because we cannot win this with a military, power. We cannot win in a media power because we have not enough money for that. But we can really win if we win the stability and security and freedom of every Russian living in Latvia. So that has changed, but I'm also be very, very direct. We are going to increase the military expenses, double them in 3 years. Because if we compare before Georgia and Russian war, not too much military activities. NATO, Russia's border, Russia always said, this is a threat. Sorry, green, peaceful border. Less visible than this fence and the video cameras on South Ossetia. After the war, we really said that we had to be careful. We have to be really creating a contingency planning, regional contingency planning. If something happens, because, you know, this was attack on Georgia. If somebody says that Georgia attacked Russia, then it's ridiculous. It's impossible. It's impossible to do that. So afterwards we had a contingency plan, because then we had only 4 F-16s guarding or policing our after Crimea and Eastern Ukraine. I don't know how many times we have doubled the military presence of NATO, but we at least tripled the fighter jets. There are a lot of tanks, American soldiers, you know, British soldiers, Italian soldiers. There are permanent bases rotating all the time. And we have to pay more for what's called the host nation support. Which is really a part of the collective defense. A smart defense, because NATO is the most successful and maybe the only one successful military alliance in the world's history. And that's really true. That's really true. And what else? You have to show yourselves that what we do, you know, that we are not afraid. Because, you know, when the Russia started all these things, people got afraid. Ordinary people, you know, they said, you know, tell me please, you know, are we under the threat or not? They want to know. And that's very important to say. There is a threat, but we are not afraid. We are ready to defend our territory, and we are very good and strong allies. And make it visible. Because for the population, you should not use, you know, for jet planes flying over the villages, or let's say helicopters going around, or seeing tanks moving. They said, oh, well, the war is very close, you know, but then you have to talk to the people, understand, this is an exercise, we need this exercise, we need to show this in a very visible way that we are not going to just give up. We are going to fight for our values and for our territory. Up to now, it is very important that we have succeeded. That's a little bit nervous period is over. And what's the important message? That the whole nation is ready. That's what you have to say. And the number of volunteers in the National Guard, because we have a provincial army and National Guard. And National Guard is volunteer. It's the only volunteers serving in the National Guard. The number of National Guard doubled during the last year since Ukraine started. And that is a very, very good signal to Russia. We are ready to defend our values and our territory. It's relevant to you all. It's nothing very new. But unfortunately, the world has changed. We have to adapt.
Thank you, Mr. President. And the floor is open. Yes, please. There must be a microphone somewhere there.
I'm Katina Burkace. I'm a professor in the field of international law. Thank you for very useful presentation and talking points. Of course, unfortunately, based on Georgian case, occupation after this annexation in Ukraine, unfortunately, we must mention that international community, international legal framework does not have an effective mechanism in order to prevent such cases. I understand that structure of Security Council is obstacle nowadays in order to prevent such actions. At the same time, I understand that very solution is very problematic and questionable issue, but maybe solution is acceleration process of NATO integration. Maybe nowadays it's important that not just only to think about strategical view regarding the creating effective mechanisms in future. Maybe it's important nowadays to create real security guarantees in order to give opportunity states which need such support from international community and especially from NATO, because I'm lawyer and I understand that if you need real security guarantee, it means that you must be full member of the alliance. And I'm interested in your opinion about this. Thank you.
You're absolutely right. If you talk about the challenges, there's less challenges for NATO than for European Union. European Union is much more challenged than NATO, because as you're absolutely right, you mentioned that this is binding, Article 5 is binding to the member states. And NATO will never go out anywhere without a mandate of the United Nations. If it is not a member state. For the member states, Article 4, Article 5, we go. And we will go immediately. And that's maybe one of the gain from the Ukrainian crisis, you know, because all these mechanisms try to test how quick we are, how quickly we can respond, you know, how quickly we can make a decision. And you are absolutely right that it's the only organization that guarantees the security of the member states.
Yes.
But it's not guaranteeing the security of any other state. And this will be really, you know, a red line for NATO. And therefore, it's very important to become a member state. And that's it. Head of state who participated in Bucharest, I was very upset about not giving map to Georgia. And I'm still confident that if the Georgia would get the map in 2008, in the spring, there would be no war in it. But for the European Union, this is a challenge of very high stakes. Because Ukraine is a question how we are going to live further into Europe. And I would say even the Georgian destiny is going to be designed in the solution of the Ukrainian crisis. And what I have to tell you, you cannot carry two watermelons at a time. Nobody can. And you can get three, you know, 100% failure, all three fall apart. And at present, Europe will focus on Ukraine. Very much, because, and I would like that Europe to be focused on Ukraine. Because when I met Poroshenko a couple of weeks ago, I just asked what Europe can do for Ukraine. And his answer was, who knows? Be united. That's the only one, only request by Poroshenko, because if Europe is not united now, there is a hope for a good solution for the Ukrainian crisis. If there is a good solution to the Ukrainian crisis, because this is about the principle of territorial integrity, it's a good for Georgia. It's a good for Georgian territorial integrity. And it's good for every conflict frozen all around the Russia. So the stakes are very high. And the Russians are going to pay, better to say, they are ready to pay whatever the price is, but not to lose. There was also an interesting interview when the Russian official said, we all understand that economically we lose a lot, but we cannot afford the political defeat.
Yes, Mamuka, we have four questions. The last sentence sounds like the reply of the Saddam Hussein to, or no, Tariq Aziz to, well, I think it was Saddam Hussein who replied to Beijing. No Arab country ever attacked America or Israel and lost politically.
Georgiou has a center for democracy and strategic development. First of all,
just talk.
I think it is all now. First of all, thanks a lot for your time and also whatever your country is doing for Georgia. We know who are real friends. I've got two questions, or basically a double-barreled question. What you mentioned, that what is happening in Ukraine now, it poses an existential threat of European security and EU security. What I don't see, basically, is that the EU sees it as an existential threat and reacts to that as an existential threat. What I've been observing so far is that the Russian policy is this: invade first, negotiate second. This is what they've been doing. They invaded Ukraine and now they are negotiating with whatever they captured. They are, okay, so-called blackmailing some of the big countries of the European Union to make sure that they get the best deal. And sufferers of these negotiations seems to be Georgia, Ukraine itself, and Moldova, because the price that the Russians are asking is to basically to neglect those three countries, to block the future European prospects for this. My question is, how far you think this invade first, negotiate second policy can continue, and what will be the consequences of that? Because everybody understands that it's just satisfaction until the next dinner time of the Kremlin. And the next dinner time will come if they can get away with whatever they did in Ukraine. And second, you mentioned that basically you can't afford to counteract against Russian propaganda by investing in the media. I fully understand that Latvia is a small country and it's not a match with the Russian kind of machine that has billions of hundreds of millions of dollars. The other day I was reading that Putin is going to spend only this year more than 600 million euros for Russian propaganda. And as far as I know, EU is spending less than 10 million euros for promotion of Eastern Partnership. Okay, I understand that Latvia is a small country, but why on earth European Union as a whole, which can afford a lot more than the Russian ailing economy can, can't basically counteract against Russian propaganda and boost, okay, let's say, fair news coverage?
Okay. Yeah, thank you. It's the only way out. Because when about 8 years ago, I was talking to the people from the State Department in the United States, and they asked me the same questions. What we can do for you? I said, please create one Russian channel. I said, no, it's not a business. I said, it's not a business, it's politics. It's a future strategy, because if you you will not approach the minds of the Russian populations in Baltic states, one day will be in a trouble. Now, when Ukraine happened, everybody understood that this is a must-to-do thing. And of course, it's not only Baltic states, it's Finland, it's Germany, because they all have huge Russian population. And I think we will succeed on really creating one huge political Russian-speaking channel, because they don't have the alternatives. Because I'll tell you how it works in real life, from a family perspective. You watch in the evening the TV. You need some excitement. You need some entertainment. You know, how much Russia spends on entertainment programs, even if those are copied from American or whatever German programs, they are professionally much better. And in between, they are the news, which damage the society. Because the society wants to be entertained, they entertain, and then they got the bad news. Okay, good news for Russia. So, and then you have some stereotypes you cannot change. The people think, you know, how we can create as professional entertainment programs to compete with the Russian. I said, buy from Russians. I said it in a governmental meeting in my country. And they said, how? We are going to buy Russian entertainment programs to show on our national TV? I said, yes. And put our news in between. You see, you have to find out the tools, how to really react. Because the people are very simple. They want to relax. Give them this opportunity. Relaxing with the problems they really like. But I'll tell you one more thing. 8 years ago, when I became a president, just months before, and I was watching the TV in Moscow, because I was there with a lecture on orthopedic surgery. And in the break time, I came up to my apartment, and my wife said, look, they have a very nice program called Cultural Channel. Very good. Very, you know, very, very good intellectual channel. What I have to do? I just visited the ambassador of Russia and said, you know, you have a very nice cultural channel. We would like to have it in Latvia. He said, yes, okay, I'll think about that. Then I met the Minister of Culture of Russia and asked the same question, you know, we need the cultural channel, you know. Could we provide it? He said, yes, but nothing happened. And 3 years later, I said, what's the problem with one channel? We have stupid Russian channels, about two dozens, you know, and you cannot, you know, provide us with one very good channel. He said, property rights. Then you see, you know, when you need a propaganda channel, no property rights at all. All belongs to Putin. When you need a culture. So it's a battle in which we have to be very smart. So, and then you said about invade first. It was even much more complicated. There was a very good statement from one of the assistants of Putin in a Merab conference in Tallinn a few weeks ago. And he said, Putin started to prepare for Ukrainian war 10 years ago. And I trust him. That's true. Ukraine was first attacked economically, then financially, then by media attack. And only then the green man came in and tried to change something. And only afterwards the army came in. And that is a special KGB operation, and he's very proud of that. So we have to learn lessons from that. It may happen anywhere. But they will not go out in the near future.
Thank you. Mr. President, if you don't mind, we'll collect questions. Yep. There are three more coming, and then we'll So I had one question from the area, please, and then Mamuka and Nick. Students first. I'm sorry.
And my name is Salome Kutashvili, the future diplomats club. My question is, how do you think the current political and economical problems will affect the association agreement to European Union or not?
The Georgian problem?
Yes.
That's a Georgian problem. I will tell you why. Because, you know, the economy is driven by the people. It's driven by environment, the positive environment created by the government in Georgia, you know? And nobody from outside can influence it. Okay, investments, it's another question. Investments will come when there will be stability, and there will be, you know, protection of investments, and then there will be, you know, at least, you know, long-lasting strategy of development of the country. It's coming soon. It's really coming soon. Because you have to understand that after the economic and financial crisis, there were not investments all over the world too much. Nobody wanted to invest in it, it's a stable, you know, global situation. It's nothing to do with Georgia.
Uncle.
Thank you, Mamuka, without public from Liberian. Thank you very much for your personal help and contribution, Mr. President, for years you served, especially for Bucharest. I do remember how strong was your support, and that's why we got at the very last minute this membership promise. Continuing on NATO, what new ideas Latvian folks are throwing around in NATO, and what they would like to see NATO doing more, including maybe even bilateral stationing of some troops permanently? And second, if you can tell us briefly what you and what we should expect from the summit, we should be aware of what's going on.
About NATO, the Latvian position is very clear since that time you mentioned it. And quote again myself. We were in the autumn of last year discussing the before the Welsh summit, the Wales summit of Wales, what NATO can do for the Baltics. And the answer from Latvian parliamentarians to the British parliamentarians was very simple. Bring Georgia closer to NATO. And they were very surprised. They said, you Balts, are you crazy? We are offering you some support. And you said, please not support us, support the Georgians. But this is an understanding how we understand the security on a much global scale. And we see that the Caucasus is the next region to be stabilized. Okay, it's not unstable too much as compared with other regions, but basically we see the positive experience of Baltic states joining NATO, stability, security. Balkan states joining NATO, stability, yeah, and security. And much easier now, economic relations, which are very important for developing the welfare of the people. Riga is a very difficult question. Just before leaving, I had a conversation with our foreign minister. I said, well, I have to tell the Georgians about the Riga summit, you know. He said, you know, everything will happen the last week or the last day before the summit. And that's true, because that was the same situation before the Vilnius summit. A month before, everybody, you know, said, oh, the Vilnius might be a failure because we cannot deliver, we cannot sign. I would say, don't give up until the last day. And the advice for Georgians is, please pay all the attention in these last weeks on bilateral relations with the countries which are far away from you. It doesn't mean the Baltics or the Eastern countries. It means, you know, UK, France, and Germany especially. And you have to go to them and to tell them that you're ready for many things. Because, you see, you need some vertical or Christmas cards from your friends and supporters. And the Riga summit must deliver at least one congratulation card to Georgia. Of course, the visa facilitation would be the best. That would be the best. Because every Georgian citizen will be proud of that, will be happy about that, and will be able to use that. And this is a very good signal for the population. And I hope something will happen, but I cannot answer today, because the pressure from Russia started just a few weeks ago, when the representative of Russian Foreign Ministry just made a statement. The Eastern Partnership, Partnership Summit in Riga is against Russia. My answer would be, we don't care about Russia, we care about our neighbors, about the Eastern neighborhood. So let's focus on that, what we can do, what message we can send. But we should not give up any efforts getting the best possible result until the summit is over. Because we have to understand that next time that there will be a focus on Eastern Partnership will not come soon.
Public humanitarian. Thanks for straight talk, Mr. President, and your contribution to Georgia's security throughout the years that you served in office. My question is twofold. First, you partly answered it, but still, how do you deal with the Russian state TVs that are broadcasted in Latvia and are actually constantly undermining the security of your country? We got the same here. Those channels were, you know, gone off the air for 3 or 4 years after 2008 invasion, but under new administration, under new government, somehow they got on, turned on, and they are basically in majority of Georgian families. Especially they influence the Russian-speaking portion of Georgia's elderly part of Georgian nation, people who understand Russian language, because the young Georgians basically lost that linguistic skill, and so most vulnerable part of Georgian population is bombarded with that information. And second question is, you know, I've been the head of Georgian delegation in NATO PA for years, and I've attended plenty of public meetings, private meetings, you know, one-on-one meetings in NATO and in NATO PA. And throughout the years, I had, you know, very strange feeling that there was something missing over there, something like spirit, something like sense of purpose, you know, as if that team organization, NATO, was functioning by inertia, you know. They didn't have, you know, the people over there seemed to be confused, tired with all those coming problems. And do you see that? And if you do, how it could be changed to the better? I understand that directives to member countries come from their capitals, NATO itself, and NATO ambassadors do not make policies, but how can NATO as an organization, so far the best defense organization of the democratic world, can obtain and retain the viability, the spirit of it?
Yep.
Thanks.
I'll start with the end. After Ukraine, NATO has become stronger. Much stronger and much more united. You see, when you have a threat, you unite. That's a normal reaction. And if there was a question what to do, because the Afghanistan mission united NATO a lot. When I visited the Afghanistan in 2007, you know, and I started with Brussels, and I was, next point was Kabul, and the next point was Mazar-e Sharif, and the last point was just field on the ground in Fida province. That was the first time in my life when I felt that NATO is a very strong united military force. Because soldiers of all nations act together and they understand each other. And if I, when I saw the military parade in Tbilisi some years ago, I get the same feeling. I got the same feeling. So I don't think that NATO has problems. I would say even more, that NATO is very stable. And the people will look at the NATO and they will try to really create a new stable world order. NATO is the biggest player and the strongest player and most influential player. I agree with you that if you look at the political leadership, they very quickly get tired. Tired of financial crisis, tired of euro problems, tired of Greece, then tired of Spain. Now they are just, you know, afraid that they will come very tired after Ukraine. Because seeking for solutions really is energy consuming. You consume a lot of it. But you see, you know, Ukraine was a wake-up call. And of course, the Southern Europe looks more from and focuses on refugee problems in the Mediterranean Sea, which is a big problem. I don't understand, because I live in the Baltic Sea. We have no refugees coming over from Sweden. So this is something very special. We really understand in the eastern part that the Ukraine and the Eastern Partnership is a great priority. You know, a very high stakes about its future. What we have succeeded little bit in the last 5-6 months, that Europe agrees that all neighborhood policies, Turkey, Eastern Partnership, Northern Africa, are of the same priority. And the second part is that the French and Spanish and Italians, they are more experienced in Northern Africa, and Poles, Romanians, and Balts are more experienced on Eastern Partnership. And we have to share experience and make it as a priority as a whole for the whole Europe. This is changing slightly. But today I was in Gori, yeah? And there was a very interesting slide presented to me. At the beginning of the European monitoring mission, there were a lot of French, Germans, Italians, what's left today? Swedes, Finns, Latvians, Romanians, Hungarians. So you see, because they have more expertise. And all the French and the Italian, they switched to the Mediterranean goals. This is like a dividing of the labor, according to your skills. This is a good sign. What about the media, you asked? Yes? Yes, of course. What they want to tell your people, and they want to tell my people too. All your failures is because of EU. All your failures is because of America. If the Americans created the Ukrainian crisis, and so on and so on, you are nearly a failed state. You need not state. We are going to protect you in the Russian Federation. They don't say the Russian Federation, but we are going to protect you. You are a failed state. This is a typical approach. Just to reduce the confidence of the population in their state. And this is what we have to fight back. By all means. We have to tell our people that we are confident in our state. The state is responsible. The state takes the risks and responsibilities. And the state is ready to protect the population.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. We almost ran out. No. I mean, just we have time for one more short question or a very
it's
short question.
Better speech. To say short answer. Two questions and short answers.
No, answers are not limited in length.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm Selma Semetishvili. I'm former Georgian ambassador to the European Union, and until recently I was the governance director for NDI in Libya. So my question will concern, we have spoken a lot today about Russia and the challenges to the European Union from the East. but as you have correctly mentioned, those are not the only challenges. And of course, my worry is that if you look at the public opinion today in Europe, Russia is not identified as the greatest threat to the European security by many people in Europe, both amongst the decision makers and the population. Meanwhile, I want to say that I would respectfully disagree with one assertion that you have made, that Georgia cannot be politically influenced by Russia. I think that there is still a lot of potential for Russia to influence Georgia politically, and failure of Riga Summit to deliver some tangible step forward towards Europe would create a very fertile ground for that kind of mingling in the upcoming Georgian elections in 2016, and the Russian propaganda is very busy at work in our country as well. What I wanted to ask you is more about the EU security and defense policy, because today the main challenge to the EU security comes from the non-state actors, I would say. And of course, you have spoken about the NATO and expanding the NATO's conventional defense capabilities. But what about the CSDP? Do you feel that the EU might be better equipped to respond to this sort of non-conventional challenge of hybrid warfare that we see today as a main challenge to the EU, not only from the East, but also from other places in the world where the non-state actors are challenging your security? Thank you.
You see, we don't have too much non-state actors threatening security inside the EU. They're all outside. They're all outside. And of course, one of the problems is cybersecurity. And we have to pay a lot of attention to that. But basically, it's done by the national states. The nation states do not take responsibility. There's only is some coordination on the level of NATO. What we have to do, because Europe speaks about a strategic security strategy, there's not. I must be very upset. Europe has no security strategy at all. Because Europe was feeling itself like a safe place, not threatened place. Solved all internal problems and having an image that the outer problems are not influencing inner stability. I'm advocate of very, very, very brave goal. We need to synchronize NATO and the European Union just to have the same member states in the political organization and the same member states in the military organization. That would be much, much easier. And we have two neighbors, Finland and Sweden, which are in a very good cooperation military with us, but still outside. And I'm very happy, because you have to be very careful because of neutrality transition in all both these countries, that they start to discuss, and maybe it makes sense to enter the NATO. That's one thing. The biggest problem is Turkey in European Union. This is much, much bigger problem and more complicated solution is necessary to get the Turkey in the Union. It's, to my mind, these negotiations have been for so long time that they look like a little bit ridiculous to talk about that. But basically, maybe one day it will change. I agree about that with you that you still have some Russian influence in political, but this is through the political leaders of your country, not through just some leverages you have, maybe NGOs, they can create an NGO system here. They do that in all the countries, and it's called the Russian vote. But I agree with that, but you have to be careful, and you have your security institutions must take care of it. Really. I think I answered your question. There was a gentleman
in the back, yes.
Hello. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Atlantic Council of Georgia, organizing this event. I'm Merab, Executive Director of Youth Atlantic Treaty Association of Georgia. My question is regarding the foreign policy of Georgia, because there is a lot of disputes in the parliament, because the opposition always said that the government and the majority of parliament is the pro-Russia government. And my question is, how do you see the Georgian foreign policy, and how do you think the Western countries see the foreign policy of Georgia? Thank you.
Okay, I have two positive messages for Georgia. The first positive message is that if you look at the international media, and you look at what your diplomats do, and we look at what your people want, they're all on the same line. You have chosen, you have made a decision, nobody is opposing your Western European integration. People may be satisfied with the pace, maybe people may be not satisfied with the results of today, but there's no any question that you still have a discussion where to go. This is a very good message. The second good message is your parliamentary democracy has improved a lot. You don't know it, but from outside, look, every next elections you have stepped up towards the really well-functioning democracy. And the next elections are of very great importance. But you have an experience of four years of acting in a multi-political position, opposition, political system. This is a big step forward. You might be satisfied with that, what you have in the government, you might not be satisfied. But as a governance, as a democratic system of governing your country, you make only steps forward. Now, just one advice about the foreign policy, how to determine the foreign policy. We had in the first at least 15 years or even more, declaring each 5 years what your foreign policy is. And that was a time of declaration to declaration. And nobody knows who has changed it and what are the arguments behind. And then there was a decision that if you don't change too much, let's not make the strategic declarations, but let's have a parliamentary debate each year on foreign policy. That means all the parliament one day debates on foreign policy. It was not started so long ago. It was started about five years ago. Of course, the first debate was awful because everybody wants to express his pain. No disaster. We have 100 members of parliament, 33 expressed their pain and their opinion what the foreign policy should look like. And thanks to the God, the foreign ministry has prepared some report. What is the foreign policy of Latin states? And what are the priorities to their mind, the diplomatic attitude? But why am I telling you? Every next year, still the 30 people, one-third of the parliament is on a debate. But each year there's more and more consensus where Latvia's foreign policy is going. And this creates a credibility to the policy and also predictability of this policy, both for inside Latvia and especially for those outside. We're not going to change like that. Different party wins, you know, they change. Let's go north. Yes, this is advice to Georgia. When you are mature to do that, start doing it immediately. Because you will save a lot of time of the diplomats, and this will be much more efficient than just, you know, every second week asking, where are we going? What's our foreign policy? What's the foreign policy of this party? What is the foreign policy of that party? You have yearly discussions. All the parties will come to the consensus and unite under basic principles of Georgian foreign policy. this is experience of my own, because I was a president when it started. Then I was a member of the parliament and the chairman of the National Security Commission in the parliament. So I have all experience, and this year I just followed the media. But this is a really great tool for determining the foreign policy of the country.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. And,
are you tired?
No. Well, Europe is tired.
Yeah. Well, no, when I am in service for Georgia, I'm never tired.
No. Well, it reminds me that back in like 15 years ago, I remember I was sitting in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and reading the cable from the NATO, which was written by Mamuka Kudau, who was at that time a DC in Georgia mission to NATO, and he was really unhappy. I don't really actually remember the issue he was pushing for there, but I remember the emotion. He wasn't happy with this, and he said that few ambassadors told me that there is the Georgia fatigue here. It was like 15 years ago. So we nevertheless, with people like you, are fighting our way through and making progress step by step. So, and thank you, and thanks to all our Baltic friends, our Latvian friends, and all those freedom-loving people who think of Europe as all freer than peace. Thank you, and please join me thanking